Welcome to Modern Farm Business Podcast. This podcast is designed to help the farm leader bring their business to the next level. We'll cover everything from leadership and finance to strategy and planning. I'm your host, Dean Hefta. Joining us today is retired U.S. Navy Captain David Marquet. He's an expert on leadership, a former submarine commander, and author of the Amazon number one bestseller, Turn the Ship Around, a true story of turning followers into leaders. When his book came out, Fortune magazine named it the number one must-read business book of the year, and USA Today listed it as one of the top 12 business books of all time. For me personally, it's one of the books that I most recommend to people for leadership. Captain Marquet retired from the Navy in 2009. He's a life member of the Council on Foreign Relations, and in 2015 was named the American Management Association's Leader to Watch List. David, welcome to the program.
Thanks, Dean. Thanks for having me on your show.
Like I said in the intro, Turn the Ship Around is one of my go-to books when people ask for recommendations. But the events that really changed your view of leadership began with what I suppose you could consider a disappointing submarine assignment. Could you give us some background on the events that turned into the book and your approach to leadership?
Yeah. So I was a submarine captain. You know, that was what I wanted to be when I joined the Navy. That was the pinnacle that I was shooting for. And as I came up through the Navy, I used what I call a knowing, telling leadership model, which is, you know as much as possible through diligent study. And direct, tell, give orders as much as possible through clear and concise language. And propel the team forward in that way and basically be the motive force moving things forward. I was successful because I was getting promoted, but it was exhausting. And the focus was always on me and what I knew and what I could do, as opposed to activating the thinking and the creativity and the talents of the people around me. You know, the way the structure is set up, if they're doing all the same thing that I'm doing, then ideally there's some sort of a synergistic effect there. But basically, the result of one person telling everyone else what to do is the opposite. It shuts people down from thinking. So I got selected to be a submarine captain, which, of course, was super exciting for me. And the Navy sends you to a school for a year to learn the ship. And then at the last minute, I said, no, you're going to go to a different ship. After 12 months of study, they said, no, different submarine. Why? Because the captain over there had quit and they opened up this gap. And they said, well, we can't have a ship without a captain. So you're going to head over to the Santa Fe. And the Santa Fe was the Enron of the fleet. The Santa Fe was the ship that we all sort of laughed and giggled at during that year of training. They had the worst morale, the worst retention, and the worst performance of any of the submarines in the fleet. And that's why the previous captain quit. Well, the problem for me was that the Santa Fe was a different kind of ship. It was one of the newest ships in the fleet. And now I'm thrown into a situation where this very, very, very complex machine, my model of knowing and telling is all of a sudden basically out of date because I don't know. And I tried to be a knowing, telling leader. I wasn't that smart, but it was instinctual. And I gave an order, which was basically to shift into second gear on a backup motor that we only had one, you know, only had one gear. But in all my other submarines, we always had two gears for this electric backup motor. And the officer ordered it, knowing it couldn't be done. I talked to the guys after that happened. I said, look, what are we going to do? Because I don't know the ship, but you guys are all trained to do what you're told. I'm, you know, the model is for me to give you orders. And we started with, okay, so you tell me when I'm screwed up. And then someone got the bright idea of saying, well, why don't we just skip that step, Captain? Why don't you just not give us bad orders so that we have to fix? Why don't you just not give us any orders at all? And we'll just come and tell you what we intended to do. And I was like, okay, let's try it. We all shook hands on that. And we went out and it ended up being amazing. You know, we had problems and fits and starts and you know, there were a lot of nitty gritty details to work out. But basically, that was the commitment that we made. I would not tell them what to do and they would not ask to be told what to do. They would come and tell me what they intended to do.
Wow. And it seems like you were in such a research laboratory because you're in a submarine. I mean, you're not interacting with the outside world like a lot of businesses would, and you had a lot of constraints. I mean, a lot of people that own businesses might just say, well, we can just find somebody else if the people aren't performing, or, you know, if I want to motivate them, I'll give them a bonus or a raise. But on the submarine, you not only had a different situation of problems because you didn't know the answers, but you also really didn't have a lot of tools that some business owners might think that they have. Is that right?
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. I mean, a lot of business owners will say things like, well, I spent a lot of time getting the right people on board. Well, the Navy did that, but I had no control over that. And all the submarines basically have the same group of people. They're all trained. They're all recruited the same, you know, and then the Navy spreads the talent out evenly. A business leader would have the ability to fire people, which I didn't really have, and to give people financial bonuses, which, again, I didn't have. But the cool thing is, when you take away all those crutches, the thing that you have left is the ability to change the way you talk to each other and treat each other. It doesn't cost anything. You don't need any software. You know, now I think about it in terms of, we basically rewrote the algorithms by which we operated our hierarchy. And by doing so, we created a hierarchy which functioned in a different way. We kept the same rank structure. In some ways, it was very not radical, but in some ways it was radical. And so the result was, instead of saying, I need permission to do something and I need to wait for a yes to do it, we flipped it so that it was like, I'm going to state what I intend to do. And unless I hear a no, it will be a yes. And that is subtle, but it's huge. And the result is this bias for action. The team gets stuff done, because what we don't see as leaders is all this waiting around. People are waiting to get permission, waiting to convince you, waiting to create the argument that we need to do something, when they know this is just something we need to do. And so you release that. And like I said, it was amazing. We had two short-term impacts. One was that the performance of the ship went way up and we set a record. We were inspected about a year later and got a score that the Navy had never seen for how to operate, so high for how to operate the submarine, the same people. And the second thing was, every single sailor over the next 12 months who had the opportunity to stay in the Navy did, which again was 100%. So that set another record. So we had these big short-term wins. But the thing that really was unexpected to me, and the reason I ended up writing the book, was because over the next 10 years, this thing played out where 10 of the officers on the ship with me, you know, moved up through the ranks and got selected to command their own nuclear submarines. And that's out of a group of about 15. And that's a really highly disproportionate number. So what happens is, when you treat people like this and you ask them, well, hey, what do you think? What would you do? If I weren't here, how would you do this? I'm not going to tell you, even though I might think I know the answer. What you're doing is developing your leaders. And it's this talent development that creates a sustaining legacy for the leader.
Now, your situation forced you and a crew into having to figure out a different way of doing things. But yeah. Have you found that in a lot of environments, whether it's on submarines or whether it's in companies, there is kind of this attractiveness for both the boss and the employee to maintain this top down, you know, tell me what to do type of relationship?
Yeah, that's right. It's very seductive, because the boss likes it because they feel important. And they feel like they're, quote, you know, doing something. And they feel like if they don't make things happen, no one will. So they're propelling the organization forward. And employees, even though it might not feel the best, it's soothing for them. It's like anesthesia. It takes away the responsibility of doing the hard work of thinking and the ownership. So, you know, how many times have we heard people just shrug their shoulders and say, well, you know, why did you do that? That was all screwed up. Well, they told me, they, quote unquote, they told me to do it. You know, I was told to do it. It's that I was told to do it, which allows people to turn their brains off and go do boneheaded things. So if you want your people to think, step one, stop telling them what to do.
Yeah. And that can be scary for people to go through that change, isn't it?
Right. Yeah. And so the way you do it, like all change, is you do it very small steps. You do it in a way that makes it safe. Choice is a big thing. Choice is a big thing for making it safe. You don't say, okay, I order you to operate like this. You say, look, would you like to have more decision-making authority? Yes, no. Yes. Okay, great. So what I want you to do is I want you to, you know, when you come to me, I want you to, you know, just describe the situation. What we see is a lot of organizations think that you flip a switch. Like, I make the decision, you make the decision. I made the decision last week, but now I want you to make it. And you don't need to be as binary as that. You can say, look, I used to make this decision on my own. Now I want you to provide observation, description. Like, that's very safe. Okay, now I want you to provide an assessment of what's going on. Now I want you to provide a recommendation. Now I want you to state what you would intend to do if I weren't here. And so you move people up that ladder in a very incremental way.
So what are some of the principles as you're working with organizations? You're explaining this to a leader who says, I need to change how we're doing things in my company. What are some of those foundational principles that people really need to understand about this type of a change?
First is, what's the outcome you're looking for? Are we looking to win in the short run, just make it happen? Or are we looking to build leaders around us and get people to think? And if you want to get people to think, so most people kind of buy into that. Say, hey, yeah, the world's changing. I need my people to think, not just do. So I need to develop thinkers. Make it safe, not add stress. That's one of our principles. When work was physical, I could yell at people and bark at them, and it really didn't matter. It didn't have a big negative impact. But now that work becomes cognitive, stress is your prefrontal cortex is very susceptible to stress. And when we put people under stress, we know it shuts down. So make it safe, not add stress. Another one is push the authority to where the information is, not pull the information up to where the authority is. So, you know, if you're running a farm, you have distributed operations. You know, you may not be in the field. You're not looking at the crops. You're not seeing the impact of the weather. And someone else might be 10 miles from you doing that, or at a machine, or in a silo, whatever it happens to be. But rather than letting them just decide what needs to happen, we got to ET phone home, and then we got to wait. Let me describe what I'm seeing. Oh, no, send me a picture, blah, blah, blah. Okay, now here's what I want you to do. You know, so the idea is you get much more agile and resilient if you can get the people with the natively have the information just to make the decision, and you open up all those pipes. So push authority to information, not information to authority. And one more I'll give you is, when giving people authority, you got to tune it to the level of competence and clarity. It's irresponsible just to say, yeah, you get to do whatever you want. And that's why we really think you got to take these small steps, because that will allow you to assess at every step of the way, do they really understand the science of farming, and do they understand what we're trying to do as an organization? And they may understand it at a low level, but once you start inviting them to bigger and bigger decisions, that starts to fall apart. And so you want to take small steps so that you notice when that happens, and you can pause there until they develop that competence and clarity.
Yeah, that last one is really important, because I was thinking about, you said everybody that showed up on the submarine is highly trained by the Navy. So they're coming there with a known level of competence, whereas on the business world, your people might have all kinds of level of ability or knowledge or skill. And if we just say, oh, I can just turn the decision-making over to them and good things are going to happen, that could be a recipe for disaster.
Yeah, I mean, and so my guys had the ability to, like if I said, load that torpedo, they had the ability to open up the book, follow the procedure, and load the torpedo. I mean, they had that level of training. But they did not have the ability to come to me and say, hey, tomorrow I see that we're going to need to load torpedoes. It was for a number of reasons. One, maybe we hadn't shared with them what the ship was going to be doing. They weren't thinking far enough ahead. They didn't think that was a decision that they were empowered to make, whatever it was. So these are the kind of decisions that I wanted my guys to be able to make. And so we did do a lot of training on that. I ended up giving my officers almost every single week a written exam to assess their level of competence in various areas, whether it was reactor operations, tactics, enemy capabilities, whatever it happened to be. And we would give these, we would frequently give these exams. We had a huge examination program. And what I find in business is, I hire somebody, comes to me with a air conditioning tech certificate, and I just sort of assume that they know what they're doing, and they may or may not. But I'm really reluctant to actually give people a written exam and expose what they know, because I'm afraid of what I'm going to find out. If you got a contractor coming in, fine, I wouldn't do that. But, for people that you're going to develop a long-term relationship with, ask the question, why can't I give a test? How defensive would people be? And what's driving that defensiveness?
Right. Because if they know it, they should be excited to show you how much they know.
Yeah, the way we talk about it is, leaders, your job is to give people control and let them demonstrate their ability. So, this old age-old problem where I can't get promoted without experience, but I can't demonstrate my experience without getting promoted. So I can't demonstrate what I know if I never get a chance to make any decisions. So the job of the leader is to trust you and say, okay, I'm going to give you more decision-making authority. Let me see what you do with it. But the job of the team is to say, thank you. Let me expose what I know and how I'm thinking through this in a very open and honest way. And I invite feedback and criticism. Transparency over time builds trust. Like, you can't be fully transparent 1 minute and then have that build trust. And you can't be sort of transparent consistently. You need to be transparent, and you need to consistently be transparent. And that's what builds trust. And it's both ways.
David, there's a few concepts in the book that stood out to me. I'd like you to add some color to them. I'm going to bring them up and get your take on them. So one of them I'm going to paraphrase, and it's the belief that we know something limits our learning. Tell me more about that.
So this really hit me like a hammer one day. What happened to me was, when I walked from the ship I was going to be in charge of to the Santa Fe, it was obvious to me I was in a new environment and the world around me had changed. The machines were different. The buttons were different. And I knew I didn't know. I knew I didn't know. But sometimes what happens is, we go to the same office, we work the same acres of land, we park in the same parking lot, we have the same desk, and everything seems, from our perspective, it seems like it's the same, but the world around us has changed and we didn't notice. And so knowing and telling, which I thought worked, is actually not working, because you're actually telling, but without even knowing. So I would always question, I always like to play opposite game. So whenever the majority of people thought one thing, I always would sort of do a mind game with myself. Well, what if the opposite is actually true? So here's one that might be fun for you listeners. Like, the majority of talk on millennials is that, they're lazy, they're entitled, they're hard to work with, they're very transient. And as soon as things get hard, they're going to bail out and go someplace else. And so they're so much different than, quote, the rest of us. And so I said, well, what if the opposite's true? What if they're exactly like us? what would that, let's explore that. And I actually come to believe that they actually are like us, because genetically they are. Right? There's no way they're different. And I think basically what's changed is, there's so much wealth in the world. At least in America, that, kids can stay at home. They don't, it's that change. The size of housing in the United States has doubled, and the family size has dropped by a third. So per square foot, you have more room than you ever had. So basically, I think they're asking to be treated the same way we would like to be treated, but we had to feed our families. And, for them, someone else was doing that, mommy or something. Anyway, the idea is, hey, just play opposite game and just challenge the things you think you know, because things are happening so fast and changing so much that it's whenever you say, oh, yeah, I know that, you don't bother learning that. You want to create a learning organization, continue to challenge what you think you know.
That helps. Here's one more. And that's the phrase, excellence is different than avoiding errors.
Yeah. Yeah, this also hit me one day. When I got to the ship, the ship was not doing well, and it struck me that everyone was trying to avoid screwing up. I mean, the motivation was don't mess up torpedo loading, don't mess up startup and operating the reactor, don't mess up safety, don't mess up internet security, don't, you know, basically it was don't mess up. What happens when you have that mindset and you're, and that permeates the team, the best way not to mess up is to do as little as possible. Don't make any decisions. It doesn't push you towards excellence. And so I started talking about, you know what, we are going to be excellent operators of the submarine. We're going to have operational excellence. We're going to deliver combat power to the government when and where they need it in an operationally excellent way. And I stopped talking about avoiding errors. Now, the sort of the sea lawyers among us would say, well, so it's okay to make mistakes. And I'm like, well, no, but yes, but no. You know, the point is, as we get better, as we achieve excellence, the mistakes will naturally reduce in severity and in frequency. But what I want you to be doing is striving for excellence. So that provides you something to move toward, as opposed to avoiding errors, which has a sort of moving away from doing stuff. And if you want a bias for action, you need to instill in your people, hey, we're going to achieve something. Inside of that, there may be mistakes, and we were going to work to learn from the mistakes, but we got to move towards excellence.
Yeah, that's a great distinction. Are we moving away from something, or are we moving toward it? So,
correct. Because if you're moving away from something, you can move away from something in all kinds of directions.
Yep.
Right. And so, you know, there's no unity of effort. It's just everyone off running away in their own direction, scattering in all directions, as opposed to the team moving toward a vision.
Exactly. So, David, let's bring it home here. I'm a listener, and I want to build more leadership into the levels in my organization. What's one thing that you want to make sure that I take away when it comes to leadership?
When anyone comes to you and they ask you, what do you want me to do? Or do you want me to do this? Or should I schedule a meeting? Or whatever it happens to be, don't answer the question. Just pause and say, well, what do you think? What would you do? Even if all you can get them to do is simply tell me about the situation. Tell me more about that. Well, da-da-da-da-da-da. Okay, great. So what do you think? You know, I think we need to plant early this year, you know, whatever it is. And okay. You know, in other words, don't rush to solve their problems. Let them work on the problem, because that's when you're developing talent. That's when they're developing their confidence that they can solve problems. And it won't be perfect, and it won't be maybe as, quote, good as what you would have done, but consistently do that, and then you're going to build a team of leaders around you. And what you'll find is you'll no longer have to be the locomotive by yourself. You'll have a whole train of locomotives, and everyone on the team is going to start saying, hey, we need to do this. I think I need to do that. I intend to do this. And that's going to really feel good.
Joining me today has been retired U.S. Navy Captain David Marquet, author of the best-selling book, Turn the Ship Around, as well as training programs and resources on leadership. David, if people want to get more of your work, where should they go?
I'd send them a couple places. One, they can always check out the book on Amazon, Turn the Ship Around, and what just released, the Turn the Ship Around workbook. We have a YouTube channel where we have 180 one-minute leadership lessons. We call them nudges, and the YouTube channel is called Leadership Nudges. You can subscribe to the channel, and you can go to our website, davidmarquet.com, send in your stories and questions. And there's some resources on that page.
Excellent. David, thank you so much for sharing your insights and experiences with us on such an important topic.
Cheers, and everyone stay warm.
Thanks. Some excellent insights on our role as leaders and how we can affect the environment that we work within. You know, the systems around us are too complex anymore for us to have all the answers to every situation that comes up. We want to be able to rise up the leaders and grow our team's capabilities of making decisions in real time. And to do that, we need communication systems, approaches for how we interact with the people around us that allow us to pull out the perspectives and the experiences so that we can work together as a team to achieve the goal at hand. How we talk and how we treat each other really doesn't cost us anything, but the returns of that investment are tremendous. Thank you so much for joining me today with David on this important leadership topic. I encourage you to listen to it again and take some notes, refer to the show notes if you want more details, and check out David's book, Turn the Ship Around. Thanks again for joining me on this episode of Modern Farm Business Podcast. As always, send your thoughts, ideas, or insights to me at dean@modernfarmbusiness.com, and I'll look forward to seeing you again next week.